2018 nilikuwa na mimba na nilikuwa na shida ya damu. Damu ilikuwa inaisha kwa mwili. Sasa nika shemeji yangu ako Kakamega. Akaniita akanipeleka hospitali. Alinipeleka hospitali juu ya damu kuishi kwa mwili. Harakati ya kukaa kwa hospitali nikaanza kuumwa. Nikaumwa. Nikaenda labor ward. Ile nilienda labor ward akanipima. Leo walinipima. Yaani vile nilitoka ward kwenda labor ward, nikapimwa labor ward, nikapatikana mtoto amebaki, mtoto ako na 6 cm atoke. Nikalala labor ward. Fikia saa 6 mchana, mtoto sasa hakuna. Wanapima na wapati njia ya mtoto. Sasa ilibaki wananipeleka Piata. Nikapelekwa Piata. Vile nilipelekwa Piata, mtoto walitoa tu mtoto vizuri. Wakanionyesha hivi. Lakini baadaye sikujua chenye ilitendeka kwangu. Damu yangu ilimwagika yote. Walinioperate mara mbili, wakatoa yote rasi. Mimi naye nikapatikana ICU. Kalala ICU siku mbili. Baadaye nilipelekwa kwa ward. Mtoto naye alikuwa nasari. Nikakaa ward wiki moja. Vile nilikaa kwa ward siku moja, walini discharge. Nirudi kwa nyumba. Sasa vile nilitaka kutoka, daktari mkubwa wa Kakamega General, anaitwa Dr. Matete, akaniambia, ti walikuambia vile walikuoperate? Nikasema hapana. Akaniambia walikuoperate mara ngapi? Mara pili. Wakatoa mtoto, wakatoa nyumba ya mtoto. Na kisu ilishika blood na walishona. Sasa, wewe unaenda tu nyumbani, lakini ukisikia kojo ikilink, utarudi tena Piata. Nikaenda nyumbani. Vile nienda nyumbani nikamaliza wiki moja. Nikastukia tu maji, kuna maji. Maji limwagika, maji limwagika. Tena nikarudi Piata, December 19. Nikaenda Piata Mumias. Wakanioperate tena. Ikashindikana. Maji bado inaendelea kutoka. Hawakujua ishu ya fistula. Ya wao walijua tu atutia vile walinioperate. Vile walinikata blood. Sasa ni hiyo shida tu ya kutoka tu maji. Mimi sikujua hiyo ugonjwa. Yaani nasikianga tu uko siati madaktari wamekuja kutibu fistula. Sasa sikujua tu fistula. Daktari mwenye alinioperate Mumias anaitwa Dr. Oluoch. Alinioperate lakini hakushona blanda. Lakini alinioperate tu. Alifunua tu tumbo yangu yote na kushona hiyo blanda. Bado kurudi kwa nyumba nikawa tu na shida vile vile. Yaani kuna madaktari wenye wana kama mimi, yaani niseme kwangu. Niseme mimi. Daktari mwenye alinioperate juzi akushona blood yangu. Na aliniambia ati anaenda kunishona ili maji niwache kunini kutoka. Na kunifanyia hivyo. Hii tumbo imekatwa tu yote. Hata saa hii inaniuma tu. Sasa ni huyo Dr. Luke ndio yeye ndiye ametudirect tukuje gynec. Sasa nilitoka nyumbani Wednesday, nikafika hapa Thursday, nikaoperatiwa Friday. Na vile wamenioperate nimeona mabadiliko na niko sawa. Tangu nitoke Piata sijaona maji ikipita.
Mama kuna chupa poa hapo. Hadi hii ikuwe safi. Safi kama maji yenyewe. Sasa
Vile niliingia hapa mara ya kwanza, walini screen. Walinipeleka screen. Baadaye nikakuja wakanipeleka ward. Kesho yake nilikuwa nataka kwenda theatre, kaenda ultrasound. Kanifanyia ultrasound, ndio nikaenda theatre. Sasa niko vizuri, naendelea tu kupona. Tangu niingie hapa sijatumia pesa.
Na huko kwingine?
Huko kwingine nilikuwa natumia pesa. Senye nilikuwa ICU, sasa sijui vile walilipa. Lakini huko naye St. Mary mimi nilipa 50,000. Niko na mtoto mdogo wa miezi sita. Mimi nikienda nyumbani nitaambia tu wenzangu wenye wako na shida kama mimi. Wao pia yani nitawaambia penye nimepitia, yani nitawaeleza penye nimepitia na penye nimefikia na penye Mungu amenisaidia nikapata kupona. Nitawaeleza tu wakiwa na shida kama hiyo, yani wakiwa tu wakipata na shida kama hiyo wajaribu waende waone madaktari. Ni ugonjwa inaingia tu saa yote yenye haujui. Vile mimi sikujua, mimi niko na watoto wawili, lakini nilijifungua vizuri, na saa hii ya mwisho ndio nimeshikwa na nini, na fistula. Sasa naweza kuambia tu wasidharau wenzao.
Kagina lan ak Irene, nega mwa wa ichagwa kama nutet ap counseling en kwa nye chotan tenye fistula.
Outreach involves doing awareness. We go into villages. We like going back into interior parts of Rift Valley since we realized most part of Rift Valley is not covered. And it's not because that fistula is not there, no. There is fistula, but there is no awareness. That's why we decided to go outside to do outreach. We target Nandi County and Uasin Gishu County. We have strategies of doing this outreach, but us, we normally do it twice in a week, at least twice in a week. We target market places. That's where we find many women during the market day. Also, we target health facilities and county hospitals. We do liaise with the health givers there. We do connect. In case they find a fistula client, they are able to refer them to our facility since we do repair for free. Also, we target meeting places, maybe let's say counties, county governments, where if we hear there is a meeting somewhere, we work hand in hand with that. We get the opportunity, we go there, we train what is a fistula, because most people, even the learning one, doesn't know what a fistula is. So we go outside, we do awareness, we explain to them what is fistula, so that they are able to help their relatives, friends, even sisters and their mothers. So if, let's say, we go in Kabiet, for example, they are receptive. We have gone there several times. We do screening over there in the market. I thank God the government also supports us. They give us a room there. We do the screening. And at the end of the day, you can find two or three women with fistula who have never known where they can go for help. And later, they can come here, we give them the direction, they come for repair, and after repair they go back home. In other parts of Kenya, let's say in Kisii County, Kisumu County, Homa Bay, Kakamega County, we have outreach partners there who are being supported by Fistula Foundation. They go house to house. Their outreach is stronger than ours. Specifically, that's their work that they do. They go house to house, village to village, to do the awareness and mobilization. They identify the clients, and then we liaise with them. They send them to us for treatment. So that's why we found Fistula Foundation is the one which is supporting us, but they didn't cover Uasin Gishu and the Nandi and the Malakwet, some parts of Malakwet. Yeah, that's why we came out, we decided to come out and then try our best to cover the area which was left out.
Agot kounoton, komi kaimutik chechang chebune icheket yon yoe outreach.
The major problem we are encountering in outreach is resources. We don't have resources to do the outreaches. I feel for me, if we find enough resources, we'll do it better than the way we usually do. Since outreach involves also some money, for us, in order for us to move out, we need to do some budget. And it's a good budget. We need to fuel the car. People need lunch, they need water, drinks. You can see, like, the season is too hot. They need something, at least when they go in the market, they talk from one woman to another, which is not easy. So I can say the major problem we have is resources, and we are not being funded by anybody. It is just the small we try, that's what we utilize. Okay, another challenge which we face when we go outside, language. Language is a major problem which we experience. If we don't find a challenge with us, we experience a problem because most of the people in the village, they don't speak Kiswahili. They understand their local language. And actually, they feel free talking to a challenge rather than to us. If the person we are with, let's say me, I'm working with a challenge, they'll prefer talking to a challenge, especially a lady, not a man, that is in that case, they'll open up than us. We have also other cultural practices, because you may find one, you identify it as a Fistula, but the personnel will deny it. She will say, no, I'm okay, let me just stay with my problem. It's okay, I've just stayed it with 10 years. I don't want anything to do with that. Another problem, they don't believe they can be repaired for free. Whenever you tell them you can get repair for free, they say, no, maybe you are Illuminati. Where will you get free services? They refuse also.
Kiyochin kwa nyichoton counseling, kutoma giyochiga atitaye, kuhu olikaya Ruruich Irene.
First thing, she has a shock. Whenever she's coming, she feels she's all alone. She's the only person who has the problem. That is where our team, counseling team, comes in. We do that counseling before admission, just to make the woman relax, feel at home, feel she's not alone. Also, we normally show her the list. You just tell her, you can see all of these women, they have same problem like yours. That's when you will see the woman now, she has relaxed. We make sure she has relaxed first. Because if she's not relaxed, she will not go for surgery. You know, in order for one to go to theater, she has to be psychologically settled. We make sure now we have canceled, till we see she's now settled. She goes to theater. The repair has been done. She comes back. We leave her to rest the first day. The second day, again, counseling. Second session, we start another session now. So, post-op counseling. In post-op counseling, we do counsel her concerning her health now. Now we want her to heal. The healing to be 90% perfect. So we encourage her to drink a lot of water. You know, water is the key to life. We tell her the importance of water in the body, the importance of water in the healing process. We also counsel her concerning Kegel exercises, since it also contributes to healing. We also counsel her on hygiene. Most of them, they don't take hygiene as something big. You know, most of them don't even have a part, their own body. So we have to encourage her importance of hygiene, personal hygiene, tariffs, because if she doesn't practice hygiene, the wound may get gammed. She'll get infection through the place where she was being operated. We counsel her also on nutrition. We cancel our nutrition, we finish. I think the days are now ongoing. Maybe she stays in the ward for 14 days. Now when she's stable, we come in to do the third session, counseling session. In the third session, that is now psychosocial, we try to understand the social background of the woman. That's where we have more stories. Bad story studies. I don't think there is a fistula patient who has good story. Most of them, it is sad stories, bad stories concerning the husband, the child, how she will not be able to conceive again. That is, we understand the patient better now. That is in the third counseling. So from there, we are able to decide how can we intervene in, how can we help, because there must be life after fistula. This woman has come from a place where she is being neglected, stigmatized, even that has go to depression. We start giving anti-depression in the world and more counseling sessions. So next we say, how can we help? How is she going back to the society? Now she doesn't have the fistula. She's not leaking anymore. How is she going to start a life? Because fistula mostly, it leads to, you cannot move to social gatherings. You can't do your normal duties as you used to do. But now it comes to the case you have been repaired. You need to start a new chapter in life. So that is where Beyond Fistula comes in. Beyond Fistula, I really like it also. There is one donor who came and visited the hospital. And she was just interviewing us, the way you are just interviewing us. She was asking us, and what is the life after fistula now? Where are these women going? And it really helped. She came up and decided to start the program Beyond Fistula. She wanted to help young girls, children who are being raped, even the women. So we start from young children to old women who never gone to school. So Beyond Fistula, we rescue the girls. If we find one who got fistula through rape, definitely the environment is not favorable for her to stay. So we rescue her. We just feel staying with us here is safer than where she was being labeled. So we bring them in and we start following it up. When she got the fistula, which class was she on, which form was she? We look for the best school here in town. We admit them. They are just in different schools. They start from primary level. They continue secondary level, they continue to college. We have vocational program. In vocational program, we focus on young girls, let's say between age 25 and below, who are going to school and as a result they got pregnant and they dropped out the school, out of school. So they can't continue formal education in high school. So we prefer taking them to vocational. In vocational, they are being trained either tailoring course, hair dressing, or catering. Yeah, we have those one who have finished, they have graduated from vocational school and their lives has moved on. They are doing better in their villages. And after finishing school, and we start them up at business studies. If she did tailoring, we open up a shop for her. That is in their home where they come from. They apply the skills to learn to depend on themselves. After doing the forum, we came up with a conclusion. We find most of them, the husbands who left them, they come back to them. They come looking for them. After now, the girl is stable now. She has a source of income. She doesn't have the fistula. Now the man comes back to look for her. Then the family continues.
Kora, kumu negai mutikcha chang kwa ni chata ntinye fistula?
90% of women who have fistula, they are left by their men. The majority of them are divorces, all separated, something like such. If you take time and have a story with the woman, she'll tell you, the man started abusing her, saying that this is curse, there is nobody in my family who has ever experienced this and this a problem. So they just rejected the woman. They deny her all of this honor. Like there is one who was telling me, when the time she had a fistula, it was due to obstetric rape, that is, and she went to the hospital to deliver. But unfortunately, she had a fistula. And the baby died, of which it's normal. Fistula also leads to the death of the neonates. So what happened with the husband? He just came to the hospital. He picked up the body of the kid and he left the woman in the hospital. Without paying her the hospital bills, the woman stayed in the hospital for 4 months and till the hospital decided to release her. Nobody came to pick her. She also walked her. She walked around and went back to her home. Even if here in the hospital where we are, you cannot see a man coming to Fistula Ward to visit a woman. Never. If you see, it's one out of 30. And whenever we come across with such a man, we don't miss the opportunity. We take time, we counsel the man. We explain the causes of fistula. It can be repaired, and again, there will be life after fistula. You find these women have undergone through a lot of stigma. They have undergone a lot of stigma. You find there is nobody who wants to associate with them. So us, as a counselor, it's our light to talk to them, to love them. They feel loved. That's the time you realize the woman is feeling, huh? There is someone who loves me. I can also be loved in the community. I can also be loved in the society. It really helps them a lot. Because they love, the name love is just like a vocabulary to them. Yeah. So we just encourage them. You are just like another woman. You can do it. You can make it. God is with you. All such sorts of encouragement. The society also needs awareness. That is the thing number one. The society needs awareness. The society needs to know fistula is not a permanent condition. It's just a small thing. It can be repaired. And especially at gynecare, it can be repaired free of charge. Also, they should know a woman who has fistula is just like anybody. Anybody can get fistula, actually, even if you are learned or not. Anybody, any woman who is giving birth can get fistula. So to the society, I can urge them not to stigmatize women with fistula. I'm appealing to county government to come in and help us with resources to assist, to enable us to do awareness and assist the women with fistula. And even another person who is also interested can come in. It's a charity organization. If interested, you can use the number 07-08-576-330. 07-08-576-330.
Imucho go sich konig alactable fistula ko olega yellow Irene.
Most fistula is affecting young girls between the age of 17 and 24. That's where I really sympathize a lot. For example, the Alisa case, she's already by that time she's 17 years old. She conceived the first pregnancy at 13 years. She carried the pregnancy to term. She went to labor. She had a prolonged obstetric labor. The kid died on the process of delivering. But she was delivering in the village. She didn't even go to the hospital. She had a very big fistula. She stayed with the fistula since age 13. By the time she was coming here, she was 17 years. That is, she stayed with fistula for 4 years without knowing where to go for treatment. Actually, it's our awareness which made her to know there is somewhere she can get help. She came from Nandi County. She told me ever since she had the fistula, life has not been the same again. To start with, she's an orphan. That's why she opted to get married at the age of 13. At the age of 13, things never went the same. She conceived, she has a fistula. Now, the man turned into like an animal in the house. The man will go, get drunk, come home drunk. She was being beaten almost daily. She was just showing me the marks all over the neck, the face, the hands, all over. According to her thinking, she cannot go away from the man. The man is the only person she knows in her life. So she decided to cope with the man. So as in pitying came part of her life. One day the husband came, she took a panga and told her, "Now I want to kill you." She really begged not to be killed. Okay, she succeeded, the man didn't kill her. And fortunately, we went to awareness and we found the lady. She came here for treatment. Actually, when they come here, we have loyal staffs here. They just show love to those women because they have never experienced the love from where they come from. They already came here. She was treated. She was okay. But on discharge, she was not feeling like going back home. She preferred staying in the hospital environment than going back to where she came from.